Welcome back, guys. Hopefully you had a good 10-minute break, and we are now back. My name is Susie Kim. This is Wolf Schroeder, and we have the second series of the evening tonight. We have Horseman versus B-Gaming.
Yeah, Horseman versus B-Gaming, definitely going to be a closer match, I have to say. Team Efficiency did put up a good fight versus Elong, but Elong just the better team here. In this case, it's not as clear which team is actually the favorite. I think most people would lean towards B-Gaming, but you know, Horsemen have been looking better and better, and they look really cool in their horse masks. A lot of people vote for them anyways, and they say they're going to win because they look really cool in their horse masks. I mean, let's be real, okay? The horse mask is pretty awesome.
I can't stop but imagine them in the horse mask. Like, I really just picture them in front of their computers in horse masks playing and just nodding at each
exactly.
other.
Yeah, exactly. Like, no words are spoken. They're just going to, like, look at each other, and they're like, then, like, the tank switches to, like, a T-32. I'm like, how do they do it? How do they communicate?
That's how the horsemen do it, guys. All right, yeah, so horsemen versus B-Gaming. Like you said, it's going to be closer. I'm going to go with a 5-3 prediction, but I actually don't know which team is going to have the 5 or the 3.
I think I want to go with we're going to a tiebreaker, and B-Gaming wins a tiebreaker.
B-Gaming's going to win the tiebreaker?
Last time they played against each other, I want to say that B-Gaming won, like, 3 games in a row, and Horseman won, like, 3 games in a row as well. It was, like, really close.
All right. Well, the first map that we're going to go on is going to be Steps. And, we might see the same thing that we did from Team Efficiency and Elong. But, let's go into game number one and see what the tanks are. All right, guys, here we go. Set number one, Horseman versus B-Gaming, and B-Gaming is going to take the defense first.
Tank list time, Susie. We got 6 T-54s for Horsemen. That's what they like to do. And running the 5916. And on the side of B-Gaming, they're actually running that T-21, which you do see some teams run on defensive on this map. And they push it up. See, we're seeing this as a strategy again, Susie. It's what everyone loves to see.
Oh, shoot. I love
this. Pushing
that
RU-251 up there.
The conga train to get the RU-251 up onto the ledge.
Yep. We've seen, actually, them do that to the T-21 as well, actually.
Yes,
they did. In this case,
they're
going to use the RU-251.
All right.
People's like, no, 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 go
no!
down! No, I need to go!
Oh, well, you know what? Horseman is going to have enough time to go out there and take a look. They're taking shots already. They see that the entire team is together up north. Oh, B-Gaming's plan totally failed at that point. They're going to think of another strategy to use for this game.
This is just going to be an all-out brawl.
I think so, too. Super Roshi takes so much damage.
Now, this is what this map used to be like, and now we're seeing it again here. Super Roshi goes down. Good targeting for Muso. It does take some damage here.
Wow, yeah, you're right. It's just, it is a big bar brawl here. I'm waiting to see beer bottles being thrown at one another now.
Well, it looks like Taki might shatter because he's down at half health now.
But so is Feluso, and both Nipa and Archon. It looks like everyone's just taking damage here and there. No one's really focus firing on anyone. And yeah, Nun goes down, Nipa goes down, Gorilla goes down. One for one for one. They're just going to keep shooting at each other. There's Taki. You know what? If they just keep doing this back and forth, think whoever's the last tank left, they're the winners.
Yeah.
Pariah.
That's what it's starting to look
like. All right. B-Gaming, however, is down to 3 tanks. It looks like Horseman will be able to take game number one. 3v2 now.
Yep. 7mm. Going to fall last. They left the 5916 to actually do all of its damage.
Oh my goodness, yeah.
They can still win this though? Is this still winnable?
I don't know. It's really down to the wire.
Oh my god.
It just depends on the accuracy on these shots. And if Sidonia Tommy doesn't get caught out here, one more shot onto Banzai Attack.
Oh my god.
Oh my gosh, it is now.
Spencer? Spencer?
Spencer's got 2 seconds. He's going to reload. Okay, they're both reloaded. Spencer is going to be able to take more than one shot, though.
Oh,
however,
Bronze
Attack takes that win. What was that? What?
Susie, I just feel like our commentary for that game was just like an obituary section of the newspaper. like we're just like, he dies, he's dead, this person is dead, and then he's also dead.
You know what? Next time we do that, let's like start making up histories for them and stuff. You know? He's dead due to
left
cancer
behind 2 kids and a loving wife.
Oh my goodness! So analysis for that game, sir.
Okay, well everybody was just shooting at each other, but the game got crazy because now I don't know if this is something that Horsemen studied and they were like, you know what? They might do that push-up strategy, so we're gonna rush into that location. The reason why he went down, which at first I thought was a mistake, was like, oh my god, they just did all that effort, why is he going down? Then I realized they saw the tanks were coming in, and they were like, the last place we want to be right now is in a line on a wall. We're just like a sitting target there. So they did spread out, and he went right back down with the RU-251. But then things became like that brawl that we were talking about. And the focus fire was initially much better for horsemen, but B-Gaming actually prioritized their targets really well. And really it all came down to that last tank that was actually able to take those shots that were really important. And they even let the 5916 do all of its auto lure damage. That was crazy. But then it was reloading. So there was a bit of time where you could actually fight the other tank 1v1 and then take out the auto lure very, very close. And we're down to like one shot. If you miss any shot, you lose in that very last battle there. So very close game. B-Gaming takes it. But I think we're going to see a very different game number two because...
Obviously.
I don't think they're going to try to push that tank up the cliff this time.
No.
Because that strategy is clearly already known, and that sort of situation is not going to occur. I think we're probably going to see more of the standoff type style. I would expect, but you know, horsemen, known to travel together and do these sorts of engagements.
That is quite true. I see horsemen staying with the whole pack mentality.
Yeah.
But definitely, B-Gaming is not going to try the shenanigans up the mountain ever again. In this series, anyway.
Yeah, not in this series, I don't think so.
I think it's definitely going to be... So considering that, do you think they're going to change up tanks?
Honestly, they might change their tier 6 tank. But otherwise, I think they're going to keep the tank list the same, both teams. I could be wrong. That was just such a crazy first game. There's almost nothing to say except they had a plan, things went awry, things went crazy, they had a big fight, and then we're going to see what happens in game 2 because anything can happen in game 2 now. But anything except what just happened there is going to happen. If that happens again, I'm just going to lose it, Susie. I can't even describe like what we just watched there.
Well, you know, to be honest, that was a lot of fun to watch.
I hope we see it.
But I don't think we will.
But you know, like, that first game is just so indicative of how close these teams are as well. Like, how close that battle went. The target firing and just barely being able to take it. I think that might be how the series goes.
Like you said, very clearly. It's... Oh, these two teams, man, they're so, so close in skill level. We're going to have to see how game number 2 pans out. All right, in set number 2, B-Gaming did take that first game, but man, was that close.
Yeah.
We're going to see the tanks for this. And it looks
same
like
tanks?
It's exactly the same, yeah.
And you know what? I think they might actually try to push the T20 up again. Let's see if they do that. Oh my god, Susie, are we going to see the same game?
Oh my gosh.
Same exact lineup of tanks for both
teams.
No
way. That can't be the best idea. The T21 is running off right
now. Yeah, he's going off. But they pushed the RU-251. Look at that lineup. I think they're doing it. Yep, they're doing it.
Oh my god.
Oh my god, Susie, we're seeing it again.
Okay, so they're going to try to make sure that this time the RU-251 actually stays up there and doesn't fall off. But you know what? I think Horsemen, they know.
All right,
they're coming for it. Lelote is going to try to be able to ward off and tell his teammates, like, guys, be careful.
They're backing off.
They're like, oh. The team's coming.
Lolita pulls back immediately. Archon is going for him, though. He wants that shot. Decides not to take it. Just trying to get a better idea of the positioning here for B-Gaming.
Oh, gosh. And I think it's going to be a brawl again.
It's going to happen. Here we go.
Archon is focus fire down. He is going... Ooh, that was a good critical shot. He's going to die pretty quickly. There you go. Super Orochi is the next target, however.
Yep. Luso actually absorbing some of that damage there. Banzai attack gets low as well. Super Roshi again being targeted here by Gorilla. He's got no support, actually. He might get taken out here. Lolita kills Peluso first.
All right. I like the fact that the T21 is out of the battle, though. He's kind of taking shots from outside of this big brawl. He doesn't want to get hurt himself, but he manages to do some damage. Gorilla's very low. Everyone's quite low on the horseman side. And it looks like B-Gaming is going to take this.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
Oh, it's just fine. It's such good rotations to block their weakened tanks every time.
Yeah.
That's really what's winning them this fight. Also, the T21, like you said, Lolita being out of the battle until the last second here. He's not a tank that can absorb a lot of damage.
That's kind of basically what I wanted to say too. I feel like this time B-Gaming was more prepared and knew that it was going to be a brawl. They figured out how they're going to have to position themselves to not be able to take as much damage as possible. Horsemen didn't. And
the other thing they did was their autoloader, the 5916, was like always, he could have been further away as well, mm-hmm. like the T21, yeah, actually yeah. doing that extra damage, but he was always in the middle of the fight, so there was always that risk that he was going to be taken out, which meant that I feel like he couldn't have actually put as much damage on because he was always worried about whether he was going to die or not.
Right.
Like I said, Susie, I lost it. We saw the same thing. Oh my God. That just happened.
That just happened.
Now,
guys.
Imagine we go into game three.
And they do the same thing.
Yeah, they do the same thing with side swap. I hope that B Gaming does this. Karen Tiger would 100% do this. They love to troll and they love to do stuff like this. But B Gaming, I don't think so. I think they're going to play a bit more standard.
Well, they have to. I can't see them.
Well, I mean, actually, in this case, it's not B Gaming, it'd be Horsemen.
Horsemen. Imagine Horsemen start pushing up their T20. Oh, gosh. Use the same strategy against them. And,
I can't even.
We're theory crafting now.
Right now, in the team house, the horsemen with the older horse mask, they look at each other.
They're silently
like
nodding.
They're like, we're doing it.
All right. Well, yeah, like you said, they're going to swap sides now. And
I'm just like, I can't even keep it
together. What just happened?
Right now.
Yeah, I'm like.
I just can't even keep it together. The second game was much less close. It's actually incredible to me that even though Horseman basically directly countered the strategy twice, blind, rushing and expecting to do this mm-hmm. twice, they still were able to win both games. That's how good their focus firing is in these fights.
Yeah. Well, again, like I said, game two was a lot more on B Gaming's side. It wasn't as close, and it's because B Gaming did figure that out when Horseman came charging in, they were able to counter it quite well.
Yeah, I feel like if I had to say something about Horseman's playstyle, I feel like it works really well against teams who play standard because you can pick these tanks off one by one and you do this big attack and you do this big fight and you're right. able to pick these tanks off. And their accuracy is better than some of the other teams. It's better than team efficiencies. You know, it's definitely better than Run and TCSG. It's like they have a modified, better version of the Run and TCSG style. Mm. Plus, they can play the regular standard slow game on this map.
Right.
And I feel like B Gaming is kind of just saying, like, we can do this too, but we're just better at it than you. I think it might be time for Horseman to play a little bit more slowly, a little bit more carefully going into this third game.
Maybe, yeah.
That's what I would do if I were the shot caller here. I'd be like, you know what? Let's actually make that arc. Let's actually set up defensively here, and let's just like play that slow game because they are good at that as well. We've seen them do it on this map time and time again.
All right. Well, we're gonna have to see. Do you think there's gonna be any tank changes here?
Yeah. Unless they really think the M21 is really good on this map, even on the other side, like on the attacking side. Yeah, so I'm getting the teams mixed up because the game was so crazy.
The T21
yeah, the
was
T21.
On that
Sorry,
side.
Sorry, I said M21.
The T32, do you think they'll keep that one?
That's a good question. We saw Elon keep it even after they switched sides, I believe. Not today, but on other matchups.
I think today, too.
Yeah, actually, I think you're right. Now that I think about it. Yeah, when they were on the attack, they did bring it with them. It's possible. It's really a stylistic choice, like, if you're really good at positioning on that hill, like we saw Elite, actually, from Team Efficiency Day, is like incredible on that tank.
Yep.
It's actually so sad that, like, even though he was basically doing everything perfectly, the rest of his team kind of fell apart around him.
It is a team game.
It is.
Yeah.
I feel like T32 is a good pick. Is it the pick that that B Gaming wants to use here? I don't think so. I think they're just going to play a little bit more lightweight tanks.
Okay.
They are definitely switching a lot of tanks because this has taken a while for us to get into this game. Faluso is actually fixing the tank list right now. For those of you guys who don't know, we talked a lot about how B Gaming is from Japan, but Horseman is actually from Taiwan.
Yep.
So that's a pretty cool thing. I mean, Taiwanese esports seem pretty strong.
Taiwanese horses. All right. Well, I think all the tank lists are fixed now, and we're going to go right into game number three. Set number three, guys. B Gaming is up two games, and now Horsemen are the ones on the defense.
And they're doing exactly what I suggested. Not only are they bringing a T32, they're bringing two T32s. They are keeping the RU-251, which is going to help them with Spencer actually get a lot of information on the map because they're so fast. And they have, you know, standard three T54s that fill out the rest of their roster. Whereas B Gaming is keeping the T21, but they're running all T54s to support it. A much more aggressive lineup.
Wow.
And so those two T-32s can do a lot of work, especially on denying base capture. And we're seeing the Horsemen, or rather not Horsemen, excuse me, B Gaming switch up how they're playing this. They're actually sending two sets of tanks, one towards each capture point.
Yep. All right. So already shots are being fired. Horsemen kind of doing the standard, fan out around the bump Is that what we're calling it now? The bump?
Yeah, the bump.
All right, that is the bump, guys. The standard fall along the bump kind of strategy, but still they are basically together. It seems like the horsemen really do like to travel as a pack. And we can see here Spencer hiding in this bush. You can't really see him. That's really smart. But it is a common hiding spot, so he can blindly be picked off if B Gaming decides to go ahead and shoot at him.
This is a really weird position for B Gaming. I think they expected horsemen to travel together, and they wanted to be ready to counter that. But when horsemen didn't attack, like they just set up an arc, B Gaming was like, oh, that's weird. And now they're actually having to reposition again.
Okay.
In the setup phase of the game, if you get into a good position that counters your opponent's strategy, you have an advantage. But if you do what B Gaming did in this game, and your opponent is not doing what you expect, you do have to spend a lot of time repositioning, and that eats away that precious clock that you need that clock, you need that time to either eliminate or capture a base. So that hurts them quite a bit here in the early game. It's almost like you can imagine 2 minutes of the clock are just eating away here, and they accomplish nothing.
Well, they did get a little bit of information at least, and so that's one good thing
true,
that they
true,
did in 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay, so here Taki is going to go all the way to the northern side. This is what we've seen. We actually saw Elong do this earlier as well. And yeah, you can see that the horsemen, again, just spread across the bump. They are doing a very standard play, and now it seems B Gaming are going to try and emulate Elong by doing the base capture, throwing in one tank for now, and having two tanks on standby.
Exactly. As soon as that base capture gets low, that's only going to send those other two tanks in there. Archon, Sidonia, and Peluso moving around here to support Gorilla, but not finding an angle here just yet. And, you know, I feel like this is a very close game positioning-wise. I mean, that base capture is taking down, but it's likely to be reset.
It is likely to be set. I mean, 65 seconds is a very, very long time,
yeah,
especially in a base capture. Lolote is the one in that base capture point, and he is wiggling a bit to make sure that he's not a sitting target.
Yeah.
But horsemen really, they're going to need to do something. Obviously, they have 50 seconds to go and try to stop this and or pick off members of, you know, B Gaming, and it looks like only Gorilla and Banzai Attack have really taken much damage. Oh, let's add Lolote to that list.
Yeah.
And he is going to get picked off pretty soon. One more hit.
Yeah. Well, he just survived there, though. But that's that base capture reset we were talking about. We knew it was likely. B Gaming, I start to worry for them here a little bit.
With 3 minutes and 25 seconds to go, this is...
They have gained no ground, essentially, and they have been denied the base capture, which means that those two T-32s are doing exactly what they're meant to do on this map. And, you know, I worry they're not going to be able to get this capture in time. They need to start doing something a bit more radical than actually just sitting and waiting, because Horseman is just simply put not going to make a mistake in this game, it looks like. They're not overextending. They know exactly what to do. They're like, all right, you're only going for base capture point one. Two T-32s are looking at it.
All right, Lolote is going to go ahead and sit in that base capture one more time, but I don't think that's a good idea. Exactly. Just Rex on that T-32, able to snipe him out very quickly. And again, now they're down a tank, and doesn't look very good for B Gaming right now.
Look at this. Spencer sees these tanks rotating to the other side, which is really important. He may lose his life for it, but it'll absolutely be worth it. Because now they're going to be able to reposition to defend capture point two.
Mm-hmm.
B Gaming is not able to make, again, a dent in Horseman. They may even just having to take a fight because base capture is looking more and more impossible here as we now are at 2 minutes and 20 seconds.
I agree with you. And now these three tanks are going to come around the east side up to the other base. But obviously Spencer knows this. He's being the eyes and ears for the rest of his team. His teammates are going to get ready, make sure they're able to shoot down these three tanks. I think they're going to have to decide which tank they're going to focus fire first to make sure that they don't get anywhere near this base capture.
Yeah.
Already we could see fire. Ooh, that nice ricochet off of Banzai Attack. But yeah, they are going to aim at him first. Spencer behind those rocks, luckily able to survive a little bit.
But you know, they're just still continuing to buy more and more time. B Gaming actually is probably just going to have to run in here and try to take this fight. They're positioning for it. A minute and 40 seconds is still a long time for a battle to occur. It's just that they need to make a decisive move soon. Banzai Attack taking so much damage.
Oh gosh, they are. Well, here's their decisive move, right? They're just going to try to take the attack, but Banzai Attack, again, taking tons of damage. The rest of the team, though, comes out and helps them out. Now it's the brawl that we have been waiting for.
Just Rex is getting very low. A good position to actually fight him. There he goes. And this is the moment B Gaming is waiting for. 1:12 to go. If they can actually win this fight in a minute, they're gonna have to make sure no one retreats. Look at this, the 12th Clan is actually already retreating away from this location. They're gonna have to chase him.
Nipa tries to bash on him, but he doesn't. Super Orochi does finish the job, however, and it's just a brawl again, back and forth. Luckily, B Gaming's accuracy is so good. We're being able to see that they are out-positioning and out-shooting their opponent.
What? I don't think they're going to win this game because Spencer has escaped. He's already realized that this is not going to be a winnable fight, and they actually have to chase him and kill him. Even with three tanks in the capture point, they now cannot capture it. They cannot capture it fast enough. Super Roshi is on track. They do have a lot of tanks to try to solo him out here, but if he goes the wrong way, it's going to spell disaster here. I don't think they can actually find him.
I don't think they're going to be able to find him.
Look at this position. Just going to wait here.
No.
And they're going the wrong way.
Well.
Look at that.
Spencer, so sneaky.
This is like when the Millennium Falcon hides on the back of the Star Destroyer in Star Wars Episode 5.
And in 3 seconds, that's going to be it. Horseman is going to take this game.
Yep, that's it. Spencer knew exactly what he needed to do. As soon as he realized the fight was going sour, he went away. B Gaming waited way too long to make that move, and they just never gained any ground in that game.
Wow.
Really well played by Horseman.
That was really, really well played by I think that was smart. I didn't really even think about it. Sitting there going, oh, they're going to lose. Wait, where's Spencer?
Yeah. I was watching him on the mini map the whole time because I was like, why are they losing? What is the missing DPS? Oh, Spencer is missing. That's part of the reason why they're losing this fight, and he's completely far away. Even with the low health he had, doesn't matter. We've seen this before. One of the tanks just last Thursday was like hiding in the garage on Himmelsdorf with like 20 health or something. It's like, doesn't matter. The tank is alive and you don't capture the base, the game ends. So
again, we just saw how important it is to use that clock to your advantage, especially when you're on the defense. And man, Horseman played that very, very well.
Yeah. You know, it's just simply put, like, it goes down to the basics sometimes on the defending side. If you lose too much time, you have to make a move. And they just got scouted out every time.
Yeah.
So really well played by Horseman. And I think B Gaming is going to have to switch up the strategy a little bit, or at least be a little bit more aggressive.
A little more aggressive. You're right. They did waste quite a bit of time in the beginning. It almost seemed like they weren't sure what kind of strategy they wanted to go for, because they were expecting Horsemen to be more aggressive.
Yeah.
They weren't, and then it's kind of like they were left with this.
Yeah. You know, the setup phase of the game, the early game, where you set up where your tanks are positioned, no matter what map it is, if you get a disadvantage versus your opponent's setup, then you have to set up again. And then you set up, when you're setting up twice, there's a lot of disadvantages. The second setup is late, so you lost time. You're also exposed, you're vulnerable. If you're trying to set up and your opponent's already set up and you get on the edge of their setup, or if they spot you while you're repositioning, you know, you might actually end up losing some of your tanks. So it's just like a huge disadvantage early on in the game if you go position yourself to directly counter a strategy and they're doing the exact opposite. You just have wasted 2 minutes, as we saw there.
I want to see Horseman push their tanks up that mountain again.
I hope we get to see it.
Because that would be really cool to use a different, like, their strategy against them kind of thing. All right, well, here we go into game number 4. We'll take a look. Set number 4, last game on steps for the evening. We have Horseman versus B Gaming, and B Gaming up 2, Horseman 1.
All right, tank list here, same for both teams. Much more complicated tank list for Horseman. And B Gaming just rolling all those T-54s. Let's see if they're a bit more aggressive this time. Last time they split their tanks into 3 and 3, and it looks like they're doing that again. Yep, T-21 going to go out on its own for a little bit more scouting.
Yep, in 2 packs, you can see that they are going to I guess they're just going to go for each base capture. This time it's like super aggressive, like we're going to take both bases.
Yeah, they're actually moving much more aggressively than the last game. Like, they did a similar strategy last game, but they didn't move this far forward.
Okay, Horseman all together. Spencer again in the same bush as from before. He's a little big, the 12-ton. I think that the T-21 would have been able to fit in there, but, you know, the 12-ton, a little bit larger. Not quite able to hide in that bush. Lolote, look at him. See, he's so much lower to the ground.
Yeah.
And he's like the small, tiny little cute tank.
He's just so
tiny. So adorable.
Oh, mini tank.
Oh, mini tank. Okay, so Horsemen, again, they are going to be positioned. Here's Gorilla on the T-32 and Rex as well. They're going to position themselves behind that bump, and the rest of the team just kind of waiting it out to see if B-Gaming is going to make a move. I think they do want to play very cautiously, very defensively. And they're just going to just sit there and see if, you know, B-Gaming comes at them.
Right now, like, Horsemen are doing that, like, silent fist bump with all their horse masks on in the team house because they're like, oh, look, they did it again. They split. They were slow at setting up, and they have to reset up. Look at what's happening here. By the time they're actually in a position to try to deny that base capture, the two T-32s in position to deny. Also, they've lost 2 minutes of time. This is the exact same scenario. Around 5 minutes, they're actually now having to start positioning themselves, whereas the Horsemen are already in perfect place. Look at this positioning.
Yep. Like I said, the two T-32s, really well positioned. Lelote is going to be the first one to take some damage, however. Our mini tank.
Yeah.
Our cutie pie tank.
He's just so precious, Susie.
Aww.
They did put one of the T-54s in the capture briefly, but decided to pull out because the T-32s are in such a good place to deny this. And I actually really like the two T-32s. We haven't really seen it all too often on this map, and I'm starting to like it more and more. It just really suits how this map is being played right now. And if you're good at that, you know, the gun depression here, you're going to be in a good place. Look at that.
Yeah.
Oh, hit me right on the head.
Wow.
I don't care.
Oh, I don't really even care, dude. I'm just going to fling it back at you. That's what he's saying.
Yeah. Well, again, B-Gaming struggling to get any ground here. We're now down to 4 minutes. It's like each minute in this game is like sits you in this sort of situation as this marker. It's like, well, at 5 minutes, it's okay. At 4 minutes, it's starting to get a bit stressful. At 3 minutes, it's like, we might actually have to completely rethink how we're going to approach this.
They need to do something quick, like you said. And right now, B-Gaming is all over the north part of this, the northwestern part of this map. They just don't seem to really have figured out where they want to go just yet. But if you guys see the way the Horsemen are positioned, they are in perfect place to be able to defend the base capture and defend base capture number two. Also take a fight if it comes to them.
I
don't see how
they're rotating now, but it's just like last game. They're waiting. They're doing it a little bit faster. Last game this was around like 240. We're seeing them rotate like this. So they're about, you know, 40 seconds or so faster this time at actually getting this down. And they hit it really well. They used two T-54s to actually draw the fire of the T-32s to get their vision away so that they wouldn't notice that the rest of the tanks are going to the south. They're going to try to do the sandwich attack again and eliminate those T-32s. But this time, they need to make sure that they surround and make sure no one escapes. All the tanks need to be accounted for. If they're going to win this fight, they need to eliminate every single tank, not allow Spencer to escape, just like what happened last game. It cost you big. I mean, it cost them the game.
Yeah, it definitely cost them the game. Okay, here is a pack of T-54s now. They're going to travel all the way down south and into the east. They're going to try to see if they can capture the second base capture. Maybe surprise Horsemen?
I think it's really cool that they're doing this like a little bit slower than last time just to make sure that there's no 12-ton out there.
Yeah, this is like a split push almost, right?
They're
going to try one to distract on one base capture and then the other group distract the other one. And whoever wins, right?
It's a big charge they're going in on top of these T-32s.
Oh, Feluso does a job on Lelote, though. Lelote goes down. Just Rex takes a tiny bit of damage, and again, here comes the brawl.
Here comes Bonsai attack.
But again, like you said, they're going to have to make sure that every Horseman goes down this time around.
But also keep in mind, this time Spencer is with them, so he's going to have that extra damage to lay down. In fact, there he is on the side, starting to put it down on Hiroshi. Look at that.
Hiroshi is going to turn around and try to take him out, however, and he is able to do that. Okay, so now we know that there is no tank who can run away, as everyone is in this circle. The T-32 is Gorilla. Yeah, everyone just kind of just taking shots at each other now.
In a fight like this, the T-32s are essentially worthless. That's why B-Gaming is able to take fights like this, because the T-32 fires so slowly and cannot get in a position where it can use its hull down, you know, because you're not actually going to be able to fight like that. So B-Gaming will take this fight again. But just again, I cannot even stress enough how important it was that they did that clean sweep with the T-54s to make sure no one was escaping. Because otherwise, we'd be at the exact same situation as last game. Right now, Spencer would be away. They'd win the fight, but they'd only have a minute to find him.
Yep.
This time, it's a clean sweep. They find everybody, and that is going to put them up to that 3-1 lead.
Yep. And there goes Gorilla. He was a good farmer and left behind 3 children and a wife.
Those little gorilla babies.
Oh, those little gorilla babies.
The ones with the furry hair. So sad.
Who's going to bring them the bananas now? Because daddy's dead.
Mom's going to have a hard time. Always having to reach those bananas from the tall trees that dad used to always get. She's got to shake it, but she's like having trouble raising three kids. They're like not doing their homework. It's just going to be terrible.
Oh, horsemen. Horsemen gorillas. Horse gorillas?
Well, I mean, by the way, on top of the horses and the gorillas, they've also partnered with Yogi Flash Wolves. I'm Wolf. I mean, we're getting too deep, Susie. We got to go to the next map.
Let's get back up here. We are going to Himmelsdorf. I like this. We'll go to Himmelsdorf. And I do apologize to you guys. I've been told I'm pronouncing it in a silly American way.
That's fine.
But here is Himmelsdorf. Here we're going to introduce to you this lovely city.
Yep, it's got a nice little castle as well. You know, two capture points. One capture point just got too overeager and reached out past a corner, so that creates all sorts of awkward situations on this map. See the two push patterns? One is going towards the castle, going up towards the northern part of the map. Well, I guess if you look at the main map straight on, it's like to the east, but it's the higher part of the map, so where you go up to the high ground on the east side. That's one main route of attacking. Although, if you send all of your tanks there, your opponent is going to be kind of ready for you on the other side. You kind of funnel in, so it's usually only a few tanks go there. Sometimes a tank destroyer goes up there. Sometimes you send your 5100s up there. And the base capture that the game always revolves around is that corner capture of the north. Mm-hmm. Only Elong has been able to successfully capture the western capture point at the station office, or whatever we're calling it.
The station depot.
Depot, that's right.
Yes.
So that's the other location where base capture could occur, but it almost never does. And what do you think? Do you think the attacker has advantage on this map? Because I actually kind of feel like the attacker is slightly favored because it's so difficult to defend that location. Once those tanks get in that little corner there, you've always got like one tank there. Usually it's an IS-3, and he tries to defend it, but if he messes up, it's like you lose too much momentum.
You know what's really awful is because now that you've mentioned Elong, like that's the only game I can think of, and I'm like, yeah, they attacked really amazingly, and I'm like, wait a second, they also defend really amazingly. So like, I'm really biased on which side has the advantage. I can see what you're saying, though. I could definitely see what you're saying about that. The map is positioned.
I just feel like when we have these teams that are really close to each other, the defending side usually wins. The attacking side usually wins every time. So that's just something to keep in mind. Hmm. Going to this map, B Gaming is going to be attacking first.
Yeah.
So if they actually win both attackings, then they'll actually win the series. So that's something to keep in mind.
Yep.
But I like this map, everything about it, except that corner sticks out like that, because it just leads to these crazy situations where it's like the defending team is there and they know their opponents are there, but
yeah,
they're like, well, I guess we can't really do anything about this. If we try to move in, you know, we're making ourselves vulnerable, and there's no way to like do ricochet damage. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's almost like I feel like maybe we need to start teching some SPGs in to like try to shoot that capture point from like the top of the castle, like over the buildings or something.
Oh, gosh.
I mean, it's a heavy tank map. It's a city map where like there's narrow streets. You're going to see like three, maybe even four IS-3s on this map from one or both teams. And those IS-3s always just bumping each other, like trying to stay on that corner spot. How many IS-3s can we squeeze into the corner? That's why I actually usually see two IS-3s, if you're going to see three in there, and the tier 6 tank, which is usually a 12-ton. Like, just squeezing his little body in there as best as he can, like trying to get those three tanks in there.
Okay. Well, it looks like B Gaming is going to be changing out their players. Karaya is out, and Shimip is going to be the one who comes back in for this.
Yep. We've seen Shimip actually play on this map, I think it was just last week. One of the tanks that was trying to go and be aggressive on that little corner cap, and I think it's a good choice.
Right, yeah.
He's been playing a lot more often recently. They've started fielding him like pretty consistently every day.
We definitely have been seeing him more in the later weeks than we have in the earlier ones. I think this is interesting because Steps, obviously, huge map. We just saw like light tanks and big brawls. So now we can see how the teams are going to do on a slightly more city map-ish.
Yeah,
a city map, but it's going to be a little bit different. Right?
Yeah, I definitely think we're going to see like crazy brawls on this map, no way.
Would be cool if we did, though.
It would be.
Like, just like a big AMX 5100 brawl out where they're just like shooting at each other.
It could happen.
And then everyone is like out of rounds, so they like all have to disperse. Anyway, game is ready. We're going to go right into set number 5. Set number number 5 is underway. Horseman versus B Gaming. B Gaming is up 3 games, and Horseman has 1.
So no Whoppins, actually. And we're actually have mirrored lineups. 2 5100s and 4 IS3s for 12-ton. As I was saying, the 12-ton the most common on this map for Tier 6. And I think we're going to see the entire game revolve around the contestion of this second capture point, if you will, the corner point. We're seeing Horseman actually move all together towards the courtyard, which is pretty unique.
Yeah.
Usually you rush one tank to help get into position, like one IS-3 goes as fast as they can to the second capture point. They're like trying to catch out this 12-ton, I think.
I think they're
going to try to kill him.
Okay, well, Spencer here, right at the water fountain, that's really dangerous. He doesn't have much cover in this position. That little bush, not really doing it for you, buddy. I don't think it's hiding you as well as you think you are hid.
Yeah, I think he just really wants to get as much information as possible about like how they're moving. We're going to have a 12-ton versus an AMX 5100, it looks like, on the left side of the map as well. I don't think they see each other yet.
No, they're not close enough. I mean, the mini-map makes it seem like they're very close,
yeah.
But in actuality, they're not. It looks like, though, that, yeah, Lily's just going to pull back to try to join the rest of his team. This is really interesting that they are more focusing more on base capture number one. Gorilla goes ahead and takes some damage from Banzai attack.
Yeah, you know, it's really interesting. They're actually, the way these two teams are moving is basically the same way we always see teams move, except that they did it a little bit more carefully than usual. And we're seeing those IS3s now try to push towards that corner.
Yeah, there we go. That's a little, yeah, that's kind of what we expected. B Gaming taking a longer time to really make their moves in these last few games.
Yeah, it's like they're playing too safe, which I don't blame them for, but when you're on the attack, somebody's getting into the position ASAP and having a plan that you execute immediately is the most effective way.
Okay, wow, Gorilla just right in the line of fire, standing there in the middle of this road does not seem to be a very good idea at this point. He can take some shots too, yes, but, ooh, look at that. He really needs to get out of that little road.
You know that the middle road that they're contesting here is not normally the way the defensive team approaches defending this map.
No, not at all.
And Horseman tries to make it work, but they just can't control that location. Now we've got these two tanks in here. Spencer, goodbye.
Wow. Okay, yeah, that was fast. I really like this, that they are trying to take care of this little area.
This is actually really awkward. The type 2 5100s fight. They do so much damage to each other.
This is exactly what I was talking about earlier, except only 1v1. Imagine they just go back and forth and nobody dies, and they're both just like, we're out of rounds.
Yeah, that's actually really funny. Like, I couldn't stop laughing when you said that originally. It's like, okay, it's halftime. Everybody reload.
Yep. All right. Well, there's just Rex. Fabuso is on the reload. Okay, so he's got 35 seconds left.
Notice that they're actually just going to run around here and try to take these shots. This is the kind of situation that gets forced by this base cap. That's why I think it's slightly attack favored. But, you know, Lolita is actually not being protected here, so he will probably go down.
Lolita can definitely take some shots, though. He was protected. His big IS3 brother was kind of hugging him to the wall. Now he's out. It looks like Lolita does go down. He's going to take damage. Ooh, all that focus fire onto Nun. Nun is going to die very, very shortly. There we go.
Yep. Taki taking some damage. Or doing some damage, yeah.
Doing damage. And members of Horseman. And members are just dropping like flies left and right. It is now down to Sidonia, Tommy, and Archon versus Banzai, Shimmick, and Taki.
They should not be going down this choke point. There's no reason to chase right now. There's no reason to chase.
No.
They want to get the clock down. They're actually just running into danger. And as soon as Taki's reloaded, it's going to be a 3v2 with Taki having just so much damage potential. B Gaming, though, you know, will have to close this out. So that's the scary thing for them right now because, you know, they have time.
Yeah.
But that's the one thing that Horseman has against them.
Oh,
here.
Gosh. Shimmick does do a number onto Archon. You know, it's unfortunate that they're both IS3s. They can't even run around and try to run out the clock at this point. They're just like old grandpas, like trying to cane their way around the city.
Yeah, basically.
Now it's just a waiting game. Yeah, it looks like, Taki is up, and they're going to try to finish up this job. Archon does take some damage. Banzai attack on the reload. It looks like Archon's just going to try to bash into him while Sidonia comes around and tries to hit him. Also, there goes Banzai. Now it is a 2v2, but
this is absolutely winnable here for Horseman. They can win this.
I don't know, man.
Like, if Archon gets that shot off on Taki, and not the other way around, which Taki's going for it! Okay, now they can't win. I mean, they can, but they probably
won't. Well, Sidonia Tommy needs to run away somewhere, unless he's going to find that little garage from before her.
Yeah, but even that is kind of predictable at this point. There's still a lot of time left.
Absolutely. A minute and 44, and yeah, Tommy is taking tons of damage. He's down to 350 versus an AMX 5100 and an IS-3? Yeah, I don't think that's going to happen.
I mean, his positioning is basically perfect here, but Shmip's going to take this next shot. He's not going to be around the corner in time! And there it is.
Oh, gosh.
B-Gaming taking that fourth win. Now one win away from winning the series with a 5-1 score. I hate to say it, and I don't want to be critical, but B-Gaming is bad on attack side today. They won that game, but they are just so too patient. Like,
I don't even want to say patient. I almost want to say indecisive.
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't even seem like they have a strategy and they're being patient with it. It's kind of like a, we don't know what we want to do, so we're just going to, like, hang out for a while. Yes, I will agree with you on that. B-Gaming not really showing us what they
Because basically almost every game we're having is B-Gaming's plan going awry, or they're taking too long to do it. And then they get behind, and then they just win the fight and win the game anyways. But, like, that's how these games have been going.
Yeah.
Like, their capture attempt looked really weak there. Like, they got pushed off so easily, and they lost their tanks early on. Like, the tanks they had set up there to try to, you know, force that capture. And they still were able to win just for superior control. But it was a close call. Like, every single game, it's a close call. They barely win it in the end.
I'm wondering, then, if they were able to, attack faster, do you think the games would still have the same outcome, but sooner?
Maybe. That's what I'm starting to wonder, you know? Because it's almost like they're just not really taking into consideration the clock as much as they should be. Because when the clock starts to run out, you're like, oh god, now we can do something. In that game, it ended up being fine. And again, like, I'm not even trying to speak for results, because their results speak for themselves, right? They are actually winning these fights better every time.
Right. And if they're going to do it better every time, and they've been consistently showing us this, why not do it sooner? You know what I mean? Like, why are they running the clock down?
It's a good question. I think maybe they're just not in good condition today or something like that. Not 100% sure. But we'll see if they have a different plan here going into this final game. If it is the final game, if they can win it.
If they can win it. All right, let's go into set number 6. Set number 6, Horseman versus B Gaming. This could be the last game of the series. B Gaming up 4, Horseman with 1, and here's our tank list.
Here it is. Same list as before. Mirror tanks. Draw that line of symmetry down the middle. And I feel like the way that we're seeing Horseman approach the defense here is really good. It's standard. You see the 5100s are going to the west. The 12 ton is running in the middle of the fountain.
Right.
And then you see the IS-3s, instead of actually trying to force the issue at the second capture point, they're actually trying to control that middle road, which is how B-Gaming is approaching. The problem with them last game was that even though they were in a good position, they did not win that fight in the middle. Like, they just missed a lot of their shots. Mm-hmm. Their IS-3s lost that fight. I think that's part of the reason why B-Gaming ended up winning the fight later, because those IS-3s had taken so much damage earlier on.
Alright, well, okay, so Horsemen, very unhorseman-like, have split up. We've got our IS-3s with the AMX in the courtyard, and then the 5100s over on the railroad track side, taking some shots over at Lelote. Lelote got a little too close, got, you know, his tail burnt, and now he's going to be running back to the rest of his team.
Yeah.
B Gaming, wow, we can see one up in the castle?
Yeah, they're actually, okay, so they're going to try to get vision of on the castle of that middle road I was talking about, where the IS-3s are fighting, this road right here.
Hmm.
Or no, that's the opposite side. Okay,
yeah,
it is the same road, it's on the southern side. Okay, I was like, how did they get there so fast?
Nipa from up top, he's up at the castle area.
This is so strange.
This is really different. This is not something we expected. The two AMX 5100s now are up on the castle side.
Yeah.
They're gonna see if they could, this is usually where we see like a tank destroyer,
yeah,
or, you know, and to see the autoloaders up there, kind of a different kind of strategy.
I almost felt like for a moment there that they were going to try to push the left side capture point instead. But I think they're seeing that the setup is too good for horsemen. So they're actually trying to go the other way.
All right, here is
Here's the road of
Contessa. Yeah, and they are going to take some shots. I like the shots taken at the 5100s directly because obviously you want to get rid of the tanks that's going to do the most amount of damage to you, and you want to get rid of that threat.
Yeah, you know, it's like, it's actually incredible to me that Horseman is able to identify they're up there that fast and immediately target them. That's pro gamer level reading.
Well,
right there.
You know, they are pro gamers, man.
I love that little thing. It's just problem, question mark. I don't even know what that's from, but no problems here.
No problems here. All right.
Base cap has started.
It is the IS-3 and his little buddy, the 12-ton, being hugged against the wall. I like that positioning really well. Obviously, the IS-3 is giving some great cover for him.
Yep, on that road right here, 7mm, going to take some shots. Misses Gorilla narrowly. But look at this Banzai attack and Tak. You get some great coverage from the other side.
All right, they're just going to head down and see if they can focus fire onto targets, but no, they're missing a lot. Sidonia Tommy took more damage there than he needed to. Archon is probably gonna go down.
Yeah, 7mm goes down first though. And you know what? I kind of like Horseman's position here. They're actually kind of have these tanks pinned down from both sides. Taki's taking an unnecessary amount of damage. He's actually probably about to fall. Jess Rex in a very good position with his 5100. Again, hits the Lita there.
Gorilla's down low, but he did pull back far enough that he's not going to get hit. Perhaps he could do some damage from behind. But now both teams have just kind of stopped. And they're going to reposition, try to figure out what's the best course of action. Lelote does go down, so now the base capture is reset back to 99.
Well, Nun is actually very aggressively coming up here. Taki, two shots left. Wants to take a shot through there. Misses Sidonia Tommy. Oh, man. Nun is getting really low, though.
Oh, Taki does use his last shell. Takes out Sidonia Tommy. That was well worth it. Taki now has a 40-second reload timer, but
Susie, have we seen this before? B Gaming gets really behind and they just win a fight at the end. I feel like we've seen this before, Susie.
No. Wait, when have we seen this?
Look at how well they're doing from behind.
And the Horsemen had great positioning. Yeah. They were surrounding B Gaming all around, but it just seems when it comes to the 1v1 battle, B Gaming is just on top of their game.
Yeah, they're like winning it like in four different places. And that's how they're able to take this win here.
One by one, Horsemen are just dropping like flies.
And now they have two heavy tanks, so retreat is not an option. This is probably going to be it.
I think it
Gorilla
is.
Gorilla just going to take one more shot here.
Yeah, because he's at 40.
Hiroshi, did he miss? Okay, he didn't fire it, but he did miss, actually.
Hiroshi taking lots of damage. Feluso is just shooting from the back. But now Feluso is out of rounds. He's got a 39-second reload. I don't think he's going to be able to do anything, really. Banzai Attack, you should go around the corner and find him, dude.
I don't know if Banzai Attack knows that Feluso's out of rounds, because he might not have like had a count of it.
Right.
But even still, like at this point, they know that they should know, because he wasn't firing, and now they're just going to chase him down and kill him. Feluso is going to try to hide here, but he's hiding under the curtain with his feet showing. Easy to spot. This could actually be the end here of this series.
This is actually really interesting that it's all the heavy tanks that are left over right now. So this quote-unquote chase, oh wow, he just like was hiding in the building. That's awesome. But
really smart, but they find him.
They do find him, and B Gaming is going to go ahead and win that series.
Really well played, but I have to say they showed some holes in their plays today. And the Horsemen played phenomenally as well.
Yeah.
I have nothing, like strategy-wise, I want to say, honestly, Horsemen played this series much better. But when it came to the actual fights, the accuracy, the positioning in the actual fights, that's where B Gaming shined.
Yeah.
So it didn't end up mattering that in a lot of these games that were positionally down, they had hit point disadvantages, tanks disadvantages, and still were able to win these fights because they're just so accurate. They're just so much better in that sense, which, unfortunately for Horsemen, means they lose this series. Even though I feel strategically they played the better series.
I think so too. B Gaming, some questionable things that they did, but
it's like every game we watched. Like I said, every game we watched was like Horsemen way ahead, perfect positioning advantage, hit point advantage, and then they still lose the game because they're fighting when it comes down to those actual battles. They're just having some trouble making all their shots connect.
Okay, guys. So we have notification now. TCSG decided not to show up for today's match as well. I know that they're in seventh place and all, but it does break my heart that they're not really even.
Tournament experience is tournament experience. Show up.
It would be really nice to watch you guys play.
I like the team. I like their style. I mean, it's not standard. It's not as good as the other team's style at the end of the day. But they're fun to watch. They definitely give us some of our most exciting games. So really sad that they don't show today.
So TCSG versus Karen Tigers. Karen Tigers gets an easy 3 points again. And that's going to be it. So let's take a look at the results of the evening. We had an amazing first set. We knew EL was going to win, but Team Efficiency, man, they played their hearts out.
They really did.
They did so, so well. And even though the score is 5-0, I'm going to give Team Efficiency the moral win today.
Yeah, for sure.
Then we had B Gaming versus Horseman. Thought it was going to be a lot closer. Again, like Wolf said, Horseman showing great strategy and good positioning, but B Gaming just able to execute a lot better and was able to connect those shots so much more efficiently and cleanly. And they're going to take the 5-1 win. Gives them 3 points.
Yep.
And now Karen Tigers, 3 points. That actually puts them up. No. Elong just won today, too.
Yeah, they
So they both just went up 3 points.
Exactly.
And TCSG still with 4 points, I believe.
And that's the reason why this B Gaming win is so important. Like, Horseman needed to win today to get a good advantage. Well, because, like, you know, like you said, Elong and Karen Tiger, they played against each other. They both got a win, so they stay even with each other. And you know, it's very unlikely Karen Tiger will pass Elong, but that kind of win, since Elong was likely to win as well, doesn't really mean as
right.
much. Whereas if you win against someone you're really competing with, it's like you get the points and they don't get it. So this is really important that B Gaming wins this, because now it solidifies their position that much more. In
That's
the middle
right.
of
and there's only 4 games left. No, including today. Yeah. Four matches left, basically. And everything counts. Okay, well, on Thursday, what the next matchups are going to be as follows.
Here they are. TE versus Horseman.
Oh, that's going to be a really good one.
And that's so important for the scores. And then Elong versus Karen Tiger.
Oh, that's another really good one.
Oh, my God. The last one is like going to be decent as well, no doubt. But the first two, I'm getting excited just looking at them.
Oh, wow. Yeah, Team Efficiency versus Horseman. I mean, just watching the way that the two played today, I cannot wait for Thursday to see how they face up and really face up against each other.
The winner of that match will pretty much solidify the position of those two, you know, for the rest of this match, because there's very few matches left. Like, if whoever wins this is going to pull ahead for those two. I don't think there's any way that the other one will be able to catch up after that.
Right. And Elong versus Karen Tigers. Dude, Karen Tigers have been absolutely amazing. They've just been getting better and better as the weeks go on. And this is like a test to how good they have become, you know? To play against Elong, the best team in the series, best team
in the league.
Thank you. In the tournament. And, you know, when they played before, I know Elong won that matchup, but I think Karen Tigers really might have a chance this time.
Absolutely. I think that Karen Tigers, If I had to, and correct me if you feel differently, but I feel like out of all the teams that have improved this season, even though Karen Tiger's pretty much always been second, I feel like they've also improved the most. Like, they've closed the skill gap between them and Elong so much that if you, like, covered my eyes when they put the team names up and took them away, like, if I see Karen Tiger playing so much, I'm like, they're making Elong plays. Like, these are, like, really good, careful, incredibly well thought out and planned out plays. So, you know, it would be crazy if they're able to take an upset and win against Elong.
That would be... Wow, that would be a day for the history books, for sure. All right, well, guys, thank you so much for joining us today. We will be back on Thursday, and it's the same time. It's going to be at 9 p.m. UTC. It's 10 p.m. Korean Standard Time, and my name is Susie Kim. This is Will Schroeder. We're going to say goodbye today, but we will see you in a couple of days. Bye.